I'm going to call this meeting the Oskaloosa City Council to order. Today is Monday, May 7th, 2018. Let's start with the invocation by Pastor Don Stribling, First Presbyterian Church.
I invite those who care to pray with me. O Lord God, I thank you for the gift of living in a city where journalists are welcomed at every meeting, where meetings are done in the open, and where the work of the council may be seen and heard by every citizen. I give you thanks for providing us with a council and a city management that is always thinking of ways to construct a bright future for Oskaloosa and always willing to make the difficult decisions to assure that future becomes a present reality. I thank you for the gift of their time in preparation for these meetings so that their decisions come from informed minds that have studied the facts related to each of their actions and contemplated the effects so that all people in Oski, the least to the greatest, end up being blessed. Now, out of your great steadfast love for all your creatures living in Oskaloosa, I pray you will grant these, your humble servants, openness to one another in their sharing of ideas and concerns, wisdom in their decision-making, righteousness in their work together, and success in their efforts on behalf of our city, all so that our life together in Oskaloosa may reflect on earth the beauty and harmony of the kingdom of heaven, and thus fulfill the prayer of Jesus Christ, in whose name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor. Would you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Brennan.
Here.
Calgary.
Here.
Dennis.
Here.
Moore.
Here.
Addison.
Here.
Lawley.
Here.
Yates.
Here.
Thank you. Getting into the agenda, the first item up is community comments. This item is reserved to receive comments from the community for concerns whether or not they're included on the current agenda. Community is encouraged to come and speak before the mayor and city council. Ask to keep statements brief. Time is going to be limited to no more than 3 minutes. Any questions are to be asked of the city staff, the council members, or the mayor prior to speaking to the full council, so that way concerns can be properly researched and answered away from the meeting. Comments are to be directed to the mayor and city council only. Is there anyone who would like to speak tonight? Seeing none, we'll move on. Next item is the consent agenda. These are considered routine by the city council and it will be enacted in one motion. I didn't see anything that I needed to call out for special attention. So do we have a motion supporting the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Robinson?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Gates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Calgary?
Yes.
Dennis?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item six, this is the announcement of vacancies that we have on various boards and commissions. Applicants have to reside in Oskaloosa and be 18 years of age unless specific specifications are stated. First is the Building Code Board of Appeals. One vacancy for an ex officio member to represent the perspective of rental housing property owners and of rental housing tenants to the Building Code Board of Appeals to serve at the pleasure of the mayor. This is a 5-member board with 2 ex officio members that meets as needed. There are currently 5 males and 1 female serving with 1 vacancy for an ex officio member. The next is the Civil Service Commission, 1 vacancy to fill upon appointment for a term ending on March 31st of 2022. There are 3 members on the Civil Service Commission that meet as needed. 2 males currently serve with 1 vacancy. Historic Preservation Commission, we have 1 vacancy for an alternate member. This is a 7-member board with 2 alternate members that meets as needed. We have 5 males and 2 females currently serving with 1 vacancy for an alternate member. The Municipal Housing Agency, we have 1 vacancy to fill upon appointment for a term ending on February 28th of 2019. It's a 5-member board that meets quarterly with 2 males and 2 females currently serving with 1 vacancy. Next is the Planning and Zoning Commission. We have 1 vacancy for a term beginning on June 1st of 2018 and ending on April 30th of 2022. It's a 7-member board that meets monthly as needed, with two females and one, excuse me, 5 males currently serving. And last is the Water Board, 2 vacancies for 6-year terms that begin on July 1st of 2018, ending on June 30 of 2024. It's a 5-member board that typically meets the second Monday of the month. We have 5 males currently serving. Getting into the regular agenda, 7A is to consider a resolution adopting proposals for employee life and health insurance programs for fiscal year 2019. Brad Reiman, I believe, I thought I saw you here. Yep. We'll be reviewing the proposal regarding employee life insurance, health insurance, and flex spending plan benefits. Welcome, Brad.
Thank you. We have the agenda, so the table contents were talk about voucher vision, voucher dental, the life of the group life, flex spending account, the medical renewal, and then I did put the history in the back like I wanted done for everybody. So go to the next page. The good news is the voucher vision rate change. Now again, that's voluntary, so it's employee paid. The voluntary dental renewal went up 1%, and that averaged anywhere from 10 cents to 63 cents a month for each employee, depending on which plan they purchased. The group term life and AD&D renewal, there was no change on that. We have a rate guarantee on that, along with the group voluntary life as well. There's no change in that, which is the employees participate in that. Now, the big number that sticks out there is it says that the flex benefit account went down 9.17. It's kind of a funny thing. It went down $120. So if you look at the total numbers, so in the whole scheme of the picture of all the costs, that's $120. So if you want me to know that. All right. Then we move on to the medical insurance. If you turn the page over, you got the current, and then we got the renewal, and then we have 2 renewal options. And the renewal, if you go down the top, whether it's the renewal or any of the renewal options, the administrative costs went up 3.92%. So of the options that were proposed to the council, there's those costs will always remain the same whether you pick option the renewal option 1 or option 2. So those remain the same, went up 3.92%. Then we get into reinsurance, the specific level, which right now you're at a $45,000 specific. And if you look at options, renewal and option 1, the rates did go up 12.28. That's because both of those quotes have a $45,000 specific level. So the companies covered up to $45,000. Anything above that is insured, so anything below that. Then you go to the next line down and you look at the total annual fixed cost for the reinsurance, both 11.15 and 11.15. Now again, the difference between the renewal option 1 and option 2 is if you increased the $50,000 specific, and I'll get to that in a second. There is a savings of $24,000 if you go from a $45,000 specific level to a 50. So if you do a little bit of math, that means you're taking on a little $5,000 more worth of risk per person, which means you'd have to have 5 claims that would go from 45 above 50 to lose out on that. So again, my recommendation will be to go to a 50, but you'll have to decide on that if you want to go to that route. I think Mike and Amy can comment on that as we go through it. Now, the renewal and the renewal option 1 and renewal option 2, if you go to the bottom page, there's a prescription drug program difference. And what we're doing is your plan you have does not have the standard Rx utilization management on the prescription, which basically says there's no management, you're not pushing anybody to use generic drugs, you're not asking them to do step therapy, you're letting the doctor prescribe however they want. And what happens here is we look at cost, you're running about $13,000 to $14,000 of savings with those implementations in there. You're one of the very few of my clients and probably Wellmark's clients that don't have that benefit on there. It's called utilization. There are substitutes for generics. People may be taking a high drug and it's not, it's the same, drug, it's just generic versus brand. Your plan doesn't ask them to go to the generic. It just says go to brand. So I mean, they can go wherever they want. And it also right now, the doctor can override that. If your plan says they have to be generic, and he or she prescribes brand, if he writes DAW, then they still can take the brand. So this program will eliminate that to put a little bit more control on your prescriptions. And I think, if you remember right, Mike, was it 20 to 25% of your claims are coming from your prescriptions? So we need to start putting this kind of a management program on your plan. I'd highly recommend that, but that's something you'd have to discuss if that's what you want. So really, if you take the whole picture of it, you're overall, if you take the fixed administration costs, the fixed reinsurance, and keep it the same as it is to now, and put in the ag factors, your rate, if you went to a fully insured rate, the another way to look at it, you would have went up 7.61%. That's what that number down there says, annual maximum. That's the maximum it would have gone up. If you implement the $45,000 and put in that RX management program, then the rate would be 5.72. If you go to a $50,000 and put in the RX management, it would be 4.93. Now again, back to that 45 to 50, remember you're saving, if you look at the number annual reinsurance, and you look at, see 232, 264, everybody see that number, just go across under option one, it says 232, 264. Then you go to the right, it's 208, that's $24,000 difference. That's your savings. If you go to a $50,000 specific, you're saving 24 grand, and we've never had five claims go that. As long as I've had it, yeah. So my recommendation is definitely that, but you have to decide if that's what you want to do. Mike, you want to comment on that at all?
Yeah, I think Mayor Council, when Amy and I met with Brad, we reviewed this, and I just looked at the agenda item a little more closely, and it doesn't say what our recommendation is, and our recommendation is the renewal option number two, just so everybody knows going into this item.
How does the PBM get compensated? Is it just on a per claim basis?
They get $1.10 per member per month.
Okay. And then there's no other compensation to them?
Your plan gets rebates back from the carrier, which are put in, there are in this cost. So that on your renewal, if you go back and they will give back, I don't have the exact number, I have to look here, but there are some rebates that you got this last year. Is in the cost ready, but there's two costs back, and it is you're on schedule. If you look at the rebates, you're on schedule for like close to it. To date, you're at $7,429 of rebates came back. You're on schedule for $9,905
okay.
of rebates that come back. They're coming back into the plan, and it's already been put into the numbers. So it comes back into what you pay for the year.
Okay.
So you pay for so much, $1.10 per member per month, plus then they give you back the rebates. Now, are they giving back all the rebates? I don't know. But that's what Wellmark is giving you back is the rebates.
Okay, and that has been my concern. I'm aware that at the state level that there's some attention being given to PBMs who are doing some business practices that are being called into question.
Anybody watched the 60 Minutes?
Have been for 2 years.
That would have really hit the. That would have really been. That's a city issue in Indiana that had Express Script was their PBM, and they were holding back rebates and holding back the price, and they were holding onto a drug, and then they'd buy this other company, so they couldn't. So you couldn't get the generic part. So they controlled the cost of it and raised the cost. I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on there, but. That's a very good point.
But as long as these sort of things have been addressed, and
yes, you know, you're arguing rebate back. Yep.
Okay.
Now, I can't say whether you're getting all rebates back, whether Walmart's giving them back or not. I don't know, but there's rebates and they're supposed to be back for shipping.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. What I was primarily concerned about was that we were just paying on a per claim basis.
Right.
So.
That's great.
Okay. Any other questions for Brad?
On the front page, it says the suggested premium Who suggested the premium?
Wellmark did suggest the premium.
Okay, thank you.
Well, I don't, it doesn't say, it says, where do you see suggested? Is it at the bottom?
Fourth paragraph.
It's on our write-up.
Yeah.
And it's not.
Yeah, there's a difference between suggested, I believe, the way you give it to them, suggested and the maximum. Is that correct, Amy? I don't know what they're looking at. So
I'd say suggested's a maximum, but
yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah, suggested is the maximum.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's a difference between what suggested is versus what we actually pay.
Okay. Yeah.
Any other questions for Brad? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Brad.
So to get the conversation started, do we have a motion for one of the renewal options?
Make a motion for option number 2.
I'll second it.
Okay. Any discussion on that?
I have a question. Still, so the singles don't pay any of the premium, correct?
That's correct.
And then 5% for families?
That's correct.
Is that pretty common in city, I mean, government type situations? Is that pretty common? I mean, I don't have any ideas. So
yeah, there was it was pretty common to have 100% paid for both family and single.
Okay.
And then you might recall, was it 4 years ago? I think the legislature made a pretty big push at the state level to change things. And so that had a trickle-down effect, and locally, some contracts were modified. That's right around the time that we actually had the change to the program itself. So that's the first time that employees were contributing anything for health insurance. And so it stayed that way because we have the collective bargaining agreements and we have a grandfather status. So we've tried to retain a grandfather status and haven't changed that percentage.
So in that type of an environment, is there any incentive for employees to reduce costs or try and reduce costs?
Very good point. We've seen, I would say there's less incentive, obviously, because
okay.
they have less skin in the game.
Yeah,
but
I just want to make sure I understand.
It's something that we've monitored. I think our employees as a whole, we've done a great job of actually not seeing abuse. One of the things I'll state is we have a zero cost for emergency room visits.
Awesome.
That was something that was negotiated a long time ago for the Public Works Department. But there's not abuse of that.
That's great.
We see our employees taking a lot of generics, and so I don't think there's any abuse. We talk about that every year as if it's something that we need to address. Each year we have a meeting with the employees and review the different coverage and plans and talk about our loss and exposure issues. So not a problem.
So for last year we've had nobody go to emergency room.
Oh, I'm not saying that. No, I'm just saying it's a zero cost. But I'm not
zero cost to the employee.
Correct.
Okay.
But there's not abuse from what we can see.
Gotcha. Right. All right. Well, I appreciate that. So if they're listening, I appreciate them not doing that. That's nice to see. So thank you. I got nothing else.
Okay. Any other questions? We got the motion is to go with renewal option 2. Roll call, please.
Wallen.
Yes.
Yates.
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Calgary?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Robinson?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item B is a request from the Mahaska Community Recreation Foundation to report on the quarterly activities.
Not here.
Hi, I'm Kate Van Gelst. I am the recreation manager out at MCRF, and I'm going to report on the first quarter activities. In recreation, we had a Pot of Gold 5K that was held in March. It was a very rainy day, but 122 people came out for that 5K, so it was a good success. Little League, Mahaska County Soccer Club, and Babe Ruth all started their seasons at the end of March with some practices on the field. In community support, we did hold our annual bowling fundraiser. We raised over $6,000 for Lucy activities. The Promotions and Fundraising Committee are continuing their efforts for fundraising for soccer bathrooms. We do have a donor wall designed that will represent different levels of giving for that project. We did hold our health and safety meeting for 2018. It was very well attended. In developmental projects, the construction has begun for paving the roads out there, and we are so, so, so grateful for you guys approving that. We really, really love that that's being done. So for upcoming events, we do have a native wildflower prairie to be planted along the trail, and that will happen east of the stadium. We were informed last week that we were approved for a grant for that project, so that's very exciting. We also welcome Mackenzie McCarty as the recreation manager that will be taking my place. I'm getting married and moving away, but up until that point in June, I will be training her for my position. So that's all of the activities for the first quarter. Are there any questions?
Have any luck with the county about putting down dust control on their road?
All I know is that there it did happen a couple weeks ago, and then it rained, but that did happen. I know that they were out there doing
So they
dust
did
control.
Do it?
Yes, it
great,
was done.
Great,
yep.
Thank you.
Yes, it was very nice. Any other questions?
Thank you. Congratulations
Thank you
on
Thanks.
Your upcoming wedding.
Moving on to item C. This is to consider a resolution approving the plan, specifications, form of contract, and estimated cost for the new street lighting for the D Street reconstruction project. Garden & Associates has prepared the plans and specs for 11 new streetlight poles on D Street from A Avenue West to the east-west alley that is south of 2nd Avenue West. The new streetlight poles are planned as a result of the pavement reconstruction plans and the proposed plans to convert overhead electrical utility lines to underground electrical power distribution lines. This street lighting project is separated from the pavement reconstruction project in order to prevent delays from the Iowa DOT bidding process. And although the street lighting work is a separate project, the new light poles will be installed during the same construction time frame as the pavement reconstruction project. The engineer's estimate for the project is $165,000, and we do need to hold a public hearing. So now is the time for interested persons to express their opinions regarding the project plans, specifications, form of contract, and estimated cost. Is there anyone who would care to speak at this time? Okay, seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. Do we have a motion supporting the specifications, form of contract, estimated cost, plans for the reconstruction project for street lighting?
Move. Second.
Okay, any discussion on that?
Why would it delay the DOT?
It wouldn't probably delay the DOT as much as the DOT would delay it.
Because why?
There would have to be a contract amendment, and so that process takes quite a while.
But we knew when we started out we were going to have street lights. And we know we were going to do these, weren't we? I'm just curious what the process is.
I don't know as well. Fine, we started.
If you could go to the microphone, please, Bob.
Sorry.
I don't know that we had the actual design identified when we started the street project.
You mean of the pole and the light?
Pole.
Okay.
And we had to. We subbed the electrical work out for an electrical consultant. Staff wanted us to do it behind just so there was consistency with the street project. So by the time we would have amended the engineering agreement and then gone through plans and middles, it would have probably pushed the project back to another construction season.
Because that electrical...
They were a non-eligible item anyway.
There you go.
Because of the pole. The poles we want.
No.
Not necessarily. It's just that was not, the street lighting was not part of the original grant application. I'm not sure there would have been an eligible item anyway.
That's just like the subdevelopment, because it turned out that wasn't part of the subdevelopment, right? The wiring to the street light, am I remembering that right?
You asking me?
Yeah. That's your subdevelopment. Oh.
It's not.
Okay, thanks, Bob.
Any other questions, as long as Bob's
just
up there?
Quick clarification. So things that would be eligible for the DOT funding would be curb and gutter that's affected by the project, the roadway itself, the sewer is impacted here. So all of that, there are certain things that can be DOT eligible.
Stuff like
lighting, but not the wiring and the lights, right?
Lighting may not be, it typically isn't. It's decorative, so it isn't eligible for 80-20 funding.
City's going to own the wire and lights, right?
We own these lights.
Yes. Because in the subdevelopment, they said the people in the subdevelopment were going to own the wire and the lights.
Correct.
Okay.
Any other questions regarding this or comments? Okay, we've got a Yeah, we have a motion and a second, so roll call, please.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Badger?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Robinson?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Okay. That passes. Item D. To consider a resolution approving a site plan for the Fellowship Bible Church located at 111 North I Street. The Fellowship Bible Church located at 111 North I submitted a site plan for adding a new sanctuary building to the existing church. Subject property with a lot area of 64,400 square feet is located in a mixed-use urban corridor with an A Avenue commercial corridor overlay zoning district that permits the current land use for a religious assembly. The proposed site plan illustrates a 9,740 square foot building addition with the new site improvements. The site improvements include 240 linear feet of new curb and gutter on J Street, 275 linear feet of 5 foot wide sidewalk along A Avenue, and 100 linear feet of new 4 foot wide sidewalk along J Street. Total number of driveways accessing public street from this property will be reduced from 5 driveways down to 2 driveways to improve the pedestrian and vehicular safety. The proposed site plan provides 125 parking spaces, 55 that are on-site and 70 that are off-site, so that'll meet the requirement of 100 parking spaces for the facility. CenturyLink indicated there are existing utilities that run east-west in the vacated alley portion of this property. Staff would like to note that the easement rights for the utilities must be maintained on the subject property. Planning and Zoning Commission at their meeting on April 17th voted 6 yes to 1 no to recommend approval of the site plan with the following stipulations. Number 1, that the easement rights for the utilities be maintained on the subject property. And number 2, to provide a lighting plan to demonstrate lighting for the on-site parking lot. In addition, staff is recommending that the City Council approve the resolution for the Fellowship Bible Church with the above-mentioned stipulations. It's into that. So, do we have a motion supporting the site plan?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion on it?
I guess I was reading on in the other part of that they're going to build over that. Is that set the link stuff in a conduit through that or?
I'll let Alvin Westerkamp with the Fellowship Bible Church Film Committee discuss it.
Yes, Alvin Westerkamp. Yes, to our knowledge, it is through a conduit, and we will be building over that. CenturyLink knows about that. So, are there any other questions concerning that?
Mayor and Council, that was an item that was brought up during the Planning and Zoning Commission. And on the drawing itself, this picture here, you can see there's kind of there's the main building itself, the larger building, and then to the left, there's a smaller little corridor building that connects the two. That's the location of where the conduit would be. So it's not necessarily right under the larger portion of the facility, as I understand.
Because that's the alley.
Correct.
Okay.
Well, it won't be an alley then. But.
So there's an existing building and an existing house that will be taken down to make room for the new building. Is that correct?
That's correct. There's a house. The house also has a garage, a three-stall garage, and then the Sunday school building that is there as well.
Just another quick question. In the zoning meeting, someone talked about the concern for the appearance of the building, and that was evidently overcome by the fact that there were going to be some landscaping or something. So, Andrew, I guess you were in that meeting. Could you address what concern is it? Because it's a corrugated outside of the, it's kind of like a pole building kind of material. Is that what we're looking at, or?
So that was the concern that was brought up, and the rationale given for the one no vote on it was the simple design of the building. Fellowship Bible Church is putting brick, and then it showed on the backside, putting brick 8 feet up all the way around.
That faces the highway 92 as well, the brick?
Yes, it would be facing west. It'd be the west side of the building.
The old church.
So not north. Faces, so what's facing 92?
The old church, the original building.
Oh, the original building. This is behind it. This is behind it. Yeah. All right, gotcha. Okay. All right.
I'm just glad you can move forward. We kind of gave you a wrinkle the last time.
We did, didn't we? Yeah, so. Thanks for being persistent.
Well.
thank you for considering that.
Okay. Any other questions, as long as he's up there? Okay, thank you very much. Really All appreciate right, the you. Information. Okay. Okay. Other comments? Roll call, please.
Barnett?
Yes.
Dodger?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Addison?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item E is to consider a resolution approving the site plan for the International Ingredient Corporation located at 2387 Highway 23. They have submitted a site plan for the reconstruction of the animal feed production facility and warehouse. Previous facility was destroyed by a large fire in January of 2018. The subject property, with a lot area of 200,618 square feet, namely 4.61 acres, is located in a general industrial zoning district that permits the current industrial and warehousing land use. The proposed project features a 65,292 square foot new warehouse and production facility. The site improvements for this project include a new driveway approach onto Highway 23 and rerouting the water and sewer lines. Overall, few changes are proposed from the site configuration prior to the fire. The proposed project includes enough space for 26 parking spaces, including one ADA parking space. On April 17 of 2018, Planning and Zoning approved by a 7-0 vote a recommendation to City Council to approve the site plan with the following stipulations. First, to provide a lighting plan to demonstrate lighting for the on-site traffic circulation. Two, accessible parking and route be ADA compliant to the primary entrance and all the accessible areas. Three, provide landscaping along the southwest side of the property to assist in blocking vehicle headlights getting to the neighborhood or neighboring residential property. Now, staff is also recommending that the City Council include an additional stipulation that the applicant need to install a sidewalk per Oskaloosa Municipal Code 17.08.120 or receive the appropriate variance from the Board of Adjustment. The applicant has already submitted their variance application, and that will be considered on May 18 of 2018. So anyway, that's our item. Do we have a motion supporting the site plan for the International Ingredient Corporation?
Second.
Okay. Discussion.
So that's I'm glad they're staying.
Yeah.
Yep.
So that last item where they're applying for the variance, is our motion, I guess, what are we waiting to see if they get it, or are we moving forward with this and then we'll deal with it if they don't get the variance?
I'm guessing that this is acknowledging that there's a code that requirement for the site plan.
That's correct. There's a code provision that does require a site plan. They apply for a variance. It's in the industrial park along Highway 23. Staff perspective, a sidewalk doesn't make sense in this location, and we would expect it to be passed.
Okay. So. Yeah. So really, what we just need to do is somehow give a nod to the code that says, you know, we realize this is inside the city limits, and so sidewalks are a requirement.
Definitely.
And so I would say then yes, then yes. We need to include that.
If we wanted to, could we waive that?
Don't they have to apply first?
No. The code is very specific. You might recall when this whole issue kind of blew up. We tried to propose different amendments. We actually brought an item to you that said acknowledge, hey, the state code dictates that waiver of this particular code section goes to the Board of Adjustment, not the City Council.
Right. Right.
And so we have very specific guidance on that.
We already had that argument.
Yes.
So, do we have a motion for that with the stipulation in there?
Yes.
I didn't make the motion. I don't think I made it, did I?
I made the motion.
You made it, nice.
Okay, and there's the second. Okay. Any other comments on it? Roll call, please.
Callagher?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Addison?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item F is to consider a resolution awarding the contract to Musco Sports Lighting LLC for the new street lighting on the D Street reconstruction project. The street lighting project was advertised, bids received, and publicly read on April 25th of 2018. The project primarily includes work associated with the 11 streetlight poles on D Avenue between Avenue West and the east-west alley south of 2nd Avenue West. One bid was received for this project from Musco Sports Lighting in the amount of $159,000, which is $6,000 less than the engineer's estimate of $165,000. Musco has indicated they'll be able to reduce the contract from this bid due to changes in the design, which will be presented in a future change order. The engineering consultant for the project, Gardner & Associates, has reviewed the bid and recommended award of the contracts to Musco. If the project's awarded, construction would begin in early June, depending on weather. Anticipated work completion time is 30 working days for the project. If council awards the construction contract, then staff recommends authorizing the city manager an additional $8,000, which is about 5% of the contract amount, as a construction contingency for unforeseen circumstances, and also authorize the mayor to execute all related contract documents contingent upon receipt and approval of the insurance and bond documents. So, do we have a motion supporting this resolution?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Roll call, please.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Addison?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Reed?
I think I should abstain based upon my role with Musco.
Burnett?
Yes.
Calgary?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item G. Consider a resolution approving amendment number 2 to the contract with Gardner & Associates for the sanitary sewer improvement project. The City Council at the meeting on April 3rd of 2017 authorized a contract with Gardner & Associates to prepare the plans and specs for the sanitary sewer improvements project. Design work for phase 2 of the project has been completed by Gardner & Associates. The amendment number 2 in the amount of $101,000 to the original contract will add services associated with construction inspection for phase 2 of the project. City staff will complete a part of the inspections for items related to the cured-in-place pipe lining and the spot repairs on the project, which Gardner & Associates has estimated to be $70,000. This contract covers the inspection services for all other items associated with phase 2. Staff is recommending approval of the resolution. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion on that? Roll call, please.
Moore?
Yes.
Addison?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Calgary?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item H. It's a resolution accepting the completion of Division 1 of the Phase 1 Sanitary Sewer System Improvements Project by Cornerstone Excavating Incorporated, and approving the retainage in the amount of $14,336.90. On April 25th of 2018, the consultant engineer Jack Pope with Gardner & Associates issued a letter stating that all the work for Division 1 of the Phase 1 Sanitary Sewer Improvements Project had been completed by Cornerstone. The scope of the project involved all work associated with the installation of sanitary sewer in the area east of 17th Street and south of A Avenue. The project has been inspected by Gardner & Associates, and the work has been found to be acceptable. The final contract amount of the project is $287,337.90, after a net decrease of $1,125.85 from the original contract amount, which was $288,463.75 and had been awarded at the February 20th, 2018 City Council meeting. Approval of the completion of the project activates the warranties for the project and authorizes the release of the retainage in the amount of $14,336.90 to the contractor 30 days after project acceptance, if no claims have been filed against the project. Breakdown is detailed in our packet. Do we have a motion supporting accepting the completion of this?
So moved.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Addison?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Gates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Calgary?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item I. It's to consider a resolution directing the city attorney to initiate condemnation proceedings. This is for a property located in the city of Oskaloosa. The city of Oskaloosa has completed the design of sanitary sewer improvements for various locations throughout the city. The construction of the improvements was expected to be completed in 2018, However, the city has been unsuccessful in its efforts to negotiate in good faith the acquisition of the necessary permanent and temporary easements from the owners of the property. This property is located north of the 500 block of J Avenue East and is owned by John, Neil, Chris, Rose, Margot, and Nick Van Egmond, Maria Wiles, and Veronica Daniels. As a result of the unsuccessful negotiations for acquisition, the city must enter into condemnation process in order to continue the necessary sanitary sewer improvement project. This item sets forth the city council's direction to staff on the matter, and if approved, will formally initiate condemnation proceeding with the property owners. As a note, all the costs associated with the condemnation process will be paid from the inflow and infiltration collection system improvements projects fund. Do we have a motion supporting this resolution?
So moved.
Okay. Any discussion?
Yes, please.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
I know the family, some of the members of the family, and I had a conversation. I initiated a conversation with John Van Egmond. These are the heirs of the property that belonged to their father, Cor Van Egmond. And we talked about the situation, and John said to me, we know this needs to be done. We welcome progress. And in the words of his father, do what you need to do, just don't let the cows out. And so I'm wondering where the negotiations fell apart or what.
What you are saying is exactly correct, and that's certainly the same thing that John said to me.
Okay.
The problem, as with many things in life, of course, is that the devil is in the details. And when I visited with John, he said, Neil and I are basically the ones in charge. We're fine. Just go ahead and do it. Plus, the city has already got an easement that runs real close, but not exactly. Now, the problem is, of course, that sounds good. That makes sense. But you think, yeah, but technically that's not right if we don't have something from all the owners. I asked John, and he said, well, I can just tell you, he said, a couple of them I know won't sign. He said, we're still willing, Neil and I, okay. You know, as the ones managing the property, yeah, we're on board, there's no problem with that, but mm-hmm. I'm telling you that a couple of these other siblings will not sign.
Okay.
So we talked about it a long time, and for some time, quite frankly, tried to put a square peg into a round hole and finally decide, you know, this isn't going to work, and to do it correctly, this sadly is the step that needs to be taken. Now, hypothetically, it's possible when we begin negotiating with them that perhaps some of these others will fall in line, that as John has opined. But right now the word I've had from him is there are a couple of them he was confident would not sign, and that's why we're having to do this.
Okay. I'm wondering if this process of condemnation has any long-term effects then on property values or anything like that. If the family gets to the point where they sell the property, is this going to be an issue?
Yes and no. In theory, it does. As a practical matter, probably not. If you're familiar with the property, it's that just west of the cemetery there. Over the weekends, very frequently, I walk my dog through there every night. The area that's really impacted, that the yellow area is the temporary easement. That's not going to be a biggie at all. That's just during construction. The one, kind of the blue-green area there, if I'm not colorblind, towards the top is the permanent easement area. In theory, that could have some impact if somebody were to build in that area. However, as a practical matter, that's right along that ditch that's running through there. It's back the north end of the pasture. As a practical matter, I think it would be well nigh impossible for anybody to be building up there. So as a practical matter, I don't believe it would impact those values.
Thank you.
Which is greater, the cost that's going to cost to do this or the cost that we offered to?
You know, if we could get them a decent number, you can look back when we were condemning the property that Janet Robbins in Arizumi held out towards Penn. We had, when we talked to them initially, Mr. Arizumi indicated we want some substantial financial compensation. Would never give us an exact number. We had to go ahead with the condemnation. We had to jump through a lot of hoops because a number of the sheriff's commissioners declined to serve. We had to go back to the pump several times to get different orders. We have to pay all the sheriff's jury members. We have to pay for our appraisal and everything. Finally, the night before that hearing, the guy got in touch with me. He made an offer that if he would have said that initially, sure, we would have taken it. So in theory, that could happen here.
Okay, so that's hopefully the story. That's why I'm asking. So yeah, we didn't offer dollars yet. We never did offer dollars.
Here we have not. Routinely, the city tries to secure easements if we can without offering any money. You know, I suppose in the theory that it's something for the greater good. And historically, the city has been very fortunate with that. sometimes we've had folks that have said, no, I'm not willing to do anything unless I'm receiving something, and then we have tried to work out something with them. This one, arguably we could. The only reason we're doing this once again is just what I was saying there a moment ago, John's indication, and he said, I can just tell you there are a couple of my siblings that won't sign. Now, perhaps once we start from this point forward, the next step actually is we have to line up for a formal appraisal, but we've got to contact them and make them aware of the time so they can be there and meet with the appraisers and such. So in theory, it's possible that when we do that, that would get everybody on board and they might possibly see the light, if you will, and be agreeable to the thing. So that it's still possible we can get something done short of having to go the distance.
So the two yellow temporary easements, there's not already an easement in place for that line that goes through there?
Well, now the yellow, bear in mind, that's temporary construction easement. That's right. Basically just for getting back to there. The one where you see the green line running, that's pretty much where that ditch or that creek runs through there now. We do already have a permanent easement in place.
Oh, we do. Okay.
Right, that runs along there. And then the one to the north where it comes across from the west there.
There's a manhole out there in the middle of that pasture.
And there is. Now, as it gets designed, though, right now with the new line, it's going to be, and Jack can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think we're setting over about 10 feet. And this one, Bob's nodding, he must know the particular sign. I think we're setting over about 10 feet, so we would probably be right on the edge of the current easement, which is not, from a design standpoint, a good thing.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Warren?
Yes.
Gates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Algeria?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Robinson?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item J, consider a motion to receive and file City of Oskaloosa Rental Housing Inspection Program Audit Report. In accordance with the Rental Housing Inspection Program Administrative Policy, the City Council appointed an ad hoc committee to conduct an audit of the program. Council appointed Council Member Steve Burnett, Council Member Tom Walling, City Manager Mike Schrock, and Development Services Director Andrew Jensen. Over the past 2 months, the committee collected information, spoke with the rental inspector, and prepared the attached report that's in our packet. Overall, the committee found the program is making significant progress towards the established goals. The report includes several recommendations to adjust the program to improve efficiency and communication. The committee recommends that the City Council receive and file this report. Taking action on this report does not obligate the city to comply with the recommendations in the report, but does acknowledge this report as the basis for future recommendations that will be presented to the council. Any future changes to city code or to the Rental Housing Inspection Program Administrative Policy need to be specifically approved by City Council. So there's no financial impact to approval of this. However, some of the recommendations in the future might have an impact on revenues or costs. So do we have a motion to receive and file the Rental Housing Inspection Program Audit Report?
Second.
Okay, any discussion?
Yeah, now this committee will meet again, I assume, or continue to meet or continue to monitor this, or am I wrong on that?
I'm trying to remember. I think we appointed the audit committee for a one-off.
Yeah, Mayor and Council, I think initially we anticipated to be a one-time, once-a-year review.
Once a year.
There would be essentially another 6 months. It would be the annual report that would come out. Wouldn't necessarily be, we don't anticipate it to be as detailed or lengthy as this. It would be more of an activities or metrics type of a report. But I suppose going forward each year, it's not a bad idea to sit back and review work that may need to be addressed or done for the betterment of the program. So if you want to be on it again, let me know.
I think this audit is it's done really very well, but it was because the program was a year old, right?
About 6 months, less than 6 months.
Six?
Yeah, six okay. months.
And to see where we can make corrections and improvements. And, mm-hmm. But going forward, like you mentioned, just a spot audit, if you want to call it, brief on how it's going. Yeah. Or
maybe not necessarily harm, but just feedback from
the city. Are you envisioning some sort of a report, not unlike what we have with nuisances, for example? Where from time to time we would just have some director get up and say to the council, here's what we're experiencing, here's what we're finding. I'll throw that idea out there.
Does the rest of the council like that?
Jason doing that, or?
No, we would have development services.
Because I would be curious to see if the cost goes down like you thought it was going to when, if you change the, are you going to change the filing process, or?
So some of the, Andrew, go ahead.
Yeah, so that's one of the recommendations that came out. So rather than having landlords have to file and pay every year, the registration would just be paid every like 3 years on the inspection times. And then kind of the idea is that the they would still be paying the equivalent, say $15 per year per unit, but you would only pay that like once every 3 years, so for like one.
And the thinking that it would require less staff time.
Correct. Yep. Yep. And I mean, more convenient for landlords as well.
Yeah, that's true.
I know we established a opportunity to appeal to the Building Code of Appeals, and we have the ex officio members. Has anybody so far made an official appeal?
No.
There's not been any?
There's been discussion of it, but I would honestly say it was maybe a misguided attempt to deal with their circumstance, so no.
Okay.
Any other comments? Roll call, please.
Yates?
Yes.
Yes.
Valdez?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Addison?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item K, consider a motion directing city staff to proceed with the demolition of 313 South 3rd Street with the prosecution of the owner as a violator of Oskaloosa Municipal Code 15.30. On January 3rd of 2018, the Oskaloosa Fire Department was notified by tenants and the building manager of 313 South 3rd Street that the heat was not functioning properly and the water pipes had been frozen for 3 days. Building official inspected the property the following day and, in accordance with Oskaloosa Municipal Code 15.30, found the building to be unsafe and unsuitable for occupancy. On January 5th, the building official ordered the building to be vacated and issued a notice of defects to the property owner. The property owner was given 90 days to correct the building code violations or demolish the structure. 90 days have passed and no repairs have been made to the structure. In fact, the property has further deteriorated since the time the property was vacated. And so according to Oskaloosa Municipal Code 15.30.050, quote, in case the owner fails, neglects, or refuses to comply with the notice to repair, rehabilitate, or to demolish and remove the building or structure or portion thereof, the City Council may order the owner of the building prosecuted as a violator of the provisions of this chapter and may order the building official to proceed with the work specified in such notice. A statement of the cost of such work shall be transmitted to the Council, unquote. Staff has received two estimates for the demolition and asbestos abatement. The estimates range from $39,000 to $65,000. Both contractors expressed the actual price could be significantly different depending on the amount and type of asbestos-containing materials that are present on the property. If the council chooses to proceed with demolition, staff will have the property tested for the asbestos-containing material and put it out for a competitive bid. After the council approves the winning bid and the building is torn down, then the demo costs will be assessed to the property. Staff is recommending approval of a motion directing them to proceed with the demolition of 313 South 3rd Street and with the prosecution of the owner, Cabell Kochan, as a violator of Oskaloosa Municipal Code Chapter 15.30. Do we have a motion supporting that?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any discussion?
What is the prosecution towards the owner? I mean, I understand we'll tear down the building, but what?
It's a municipal infraction. There's a punishment of, what is it, $500 per day?
So up to $500 a day. Typically, we see municipal infractions at more like $50 a day when it comes to nuisance violations in here. But that would be...
A day to do what?
Yeah.
Because we're tearing down the building.
And that's the thing. Thank you for looking out for me. I just appreciate that. That obviously is the thing, too, that you're recognizing with it. Many times when we do that, of course, we're trying to get someone to comply and do something. In a situation like this, in truth, if the city goes ahead and tears it down, then assesses the cost and puts it on the tax rolls, I mean, then there is not necessarily that impetus to otherwise go ahead and otherwise impose an independent cost on the thing, quite frankly.
So what you end up with is a lot that has $50,000 in costs associated with the lot, plus whatever they're trying to sell it for.
Right.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, I prefer the empty lot to what's sitting there right now.
Okay. Any other comments?
Why don't we get the real estimates on the asbestos?
And we would.
We have, but we're voting on it. Why can't we have them before we vote on it?
That would be, so Mayor Council, the actual cost itself of the demolition would come at a future date with a different item. These are just estimates at this point in time. We have not received hard bids from contractors.
I get that. I'm just asking, I don't know why we don't.
But we're approving a motion to proceed with demolition at an unknown cost.
So we are having
a motion to continue to looking into what the cost is, but I'm just being a technical problem.
We haven't had it tested for asbestos. Obviously, we don't own the property. What we did initially was just contact a couple of contractors because we needed to move this forward. They took a look at it based on what they know of similar types of buildings and were able to give us an estimate. But at this time, we can't go in and forcibly remove asbestos potential material and have it tested. But this is simply an item for us to proceed down that road.
And the city's attorney is asking the council if you are interested in proceeding with prosecution with this particular owner to take an action like this. That doesn't necessarily mean that we have to demolish it. And again, I would consider this very similar to the realty Dark building,
mm-hmm.
where we had some back and forth, and eventually we had an item that said, let's go ahead and take that. And we did some work on it, found out there was a lot of asbestos there, and it came back to you and said, no way. Let's step away from that. We didn't actually take the building. We never had title to it.
Yeah.
But we had indicated that we were interested. This, I think, is a similar situation where we really want them to comply. I think we're willing to try legal recourse first, and then at least we have the council's authorization to proceed. Clearly, with the procurement process that we have in place, the policy, we have to have the right approvals to do that. This is a large expense. We'd come back to you and let you know before we actually proceed.
So this would come back to us later with final.
That would be my commitment to you, yeah.
Other thoughts or comments? Roll call, please.
Burnett?
Yes.
Gray?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Odison? Yes. Wallen?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Gets us to item L. It was noted before the meeting that this actually has a heading on it that says consent agenda. It somehow landed on the regular one. But this is to consider a motion to proceed with the survey and indicate intent to sell a portion of a city-owned lot that's located adjacent to 433 North 6th Street. City of Oskaloosa received a request from Tony Irwin, the property owner at 433 North 6th Street, to purchase a portion of the city-owned lot that is adjacent to the north of his property. He has interest in purchasing a 25-foot by 110-foot section of the southern portion of the city-owned lot to extend the north side of his property to allow the additional space and setbacks necessary so he could put on a 20-by-20 garage. City staff and water department don't have any concerns. City has no specific interest in holding this property, and no utilities are present within the portion to be sold. So selling it will not interfere with the access to any other city-owned property. The only stipulation that's been requested is that there be no additional curb cuts made, and Mr. Irwin's agreeable to that. So if the motion is approved by the City Council, the survey will proceed, and the city staff will take the next steps for the sale in accordance with the City of Oskaloosa policy on disposition of real property. After the survey is complete, the City Council will take additional action to formally approve the sale by resolution. So do we have a motion supporting getting going with the survey.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
What is that property, or why do we own it, or how did we end up with it, or has we had it for a long time? Any background?
Mayor and Council, it predates me. If you go to the north as well, that parcel is actually city-owned as well. I don't know. It's been in the city's name since I've been here prior to. I apologize. I think it's kind of a Randy Irwin deal way back when.
Okay.
But I don't see us necessarily developing this smaller section. One of the things I will note is I think we internally we have to have one more discussion about stormwater easements, because I recall we had a lot of conversation about that, so that'll be a follow-up discussion for us as staff tomorrow morning.
Okay. Other comments? Roll call, please.
Felger?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Addison?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. That gets us done with the regular agenda, winding things up. Report on items from city staff, city manager, anything.
Mayor and Council, as you received the email last week, we have the police chief meet and greet at 5 o'clock at the Musco Technology Center, William Penn University, on the 18th of May. That starts at 5 and goes until 6:30. So the public's welcome to attend. You are as well invited. Then we follow it up the next morning with interviews of 4 candidates. So we'll have you handling that as one group. We'll have a community group, department directors, and I'll do one-on-one interviews with the candidates. So that'll be Saturday, May 19th.
I know you sent us the time already. I think I wrote it down. Could you repeat it?
Yeah. It on Saturday, it'll be from 8 a.m. until, I'm assuming, 1, maybe 2. The second item of note is, you might recall we had discussions about the SRF clean water grant we had submitted for the parking lot at the Penn Central Mall city-owned property. We did not get that particular grant. There were a number of problems with our submittal, so I'll be following up on that, but I want to give you a heads up that we did not get that. The third item is the facade grant was submitted. Since our last council meeting, and we expect to hear back, I think it's in May or June. That's all I have.
Okay. For
the
next,
second phase.
Next phase.
Yes, sir. Phase two. The second phase, yes.
Okay. Now, city clerk, anything?
Nothing.
City attorney, anything?
Nothing, thank you.
Boy, we've had you speaking more than we have in many meetings.
Just muddying the waters.
City council members, Joe?
I have anything.
Okay, Diane?
No, thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to. This is my last meeting. I'll be resigning because I'm moving out of the district. So,
where are you going?
Thank you very much for everybody. Appreciate it. It's been a pleasure working with all of you.
Well, we'll miss you.
All good.
Councilman Yates.
Mr. Jimenez, do you remember what you threatened to do to me if I didn't run this last time?
I knew you were going to say that.
I feel I should have the same opportunity to do that to you this time now. All right. Good luck.
Thank you.
Nothing else.
Okay. Tom?
Radio update. We made a step forward, but we're still paying a lot of attorneys. We did pass an RFP so we can find out what the radios really will cost, so we know what we're all arguing about. So we're moving forward, I think.
Congratulations. Steve?
All good, thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Tom and I go back a lot of years. You know, we did a little reminiscing before the meeting, thinking about how our time spent together back in the 1990s. Some of the adventures, maybe that's what you can call them, that we had together. But it's been a lot of years, and it's with a heavy heart I see him go. So I wish you all the best, and it's been a pleasure being able to serve so many years with you.
So well, thank you, Dave. For that. Appreciate it.
I also want to say a special thanks to Mayor Pro Tem. Doug, you did a fine job while I was gone in Israel. It did me Greg Gobs a good. Yeah, that's one of my terms. to break away on a vacation of that nature and to know that everything was running in good hands. And so I'm very appreciative of the competency and the just how comfortable a person can be with good quality help working behind the scenes and make it easy for me to break away when I need to do something like that. So thank you very much for that. With that, do we have a motion to adjourn?
Move. Second.
Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned.